Good morning, everyone. I welcome you to lecture number 10 of our course, Collective Dynamics of Firms. I'm happy to see so many here. So we have reached the critical mass for all of those who are not here and just watch the video stream. Before I forget it, I would like to make two announcements. The first is regarding this course. Of course, the MTech has an evaluation of this course, and this will take place on the, I think it was the 18th of May, in about 3 weeks, or the 15th of May, something like this. And it's important that we have some statistics, yeah? So we can certainly deal with small numbers, but it has to be a bit sufficient. So those of you who are interested to evaluate this course, you're welcome then to join the next two lectures where we have to pass on these forms and you have to fill this in. I will also give this to Pavlin. So in the exercise, you also have the possibility to do this. So the second announcement is about a talk in the ETH Risk Center seminar series. Some of you probably know that I gave a talk last week on Tuesday about systemic risk. Some of you were there, I think you were there, right? So, and next week we have an invited speaker, Professor Sidney Redner from Boston University, a person I invited to visit ETH Zurich, and he will talk about statistical physics of citations. This came to my mind because Vahan is writing his semester thesis on a related topic, actually. So for the physicists, that's certainly of interest. You know. For the others, you think about statistics, right? Not statistical physics. You just think about statistics of citation. And it's quite surprising to see that, of course, if you look into publication data, you see the same kind of regularities that we see here with the firm data. There's not much of a difference. And even the formal models are more or less the same. This is all multiplicative growth and these kind of things. Yeah? You find power laws and log normal distributions and so on. It's just another topic, but there are similar techniques. And so those of you who are interested, it's Tuesday at 5 o'clock, one floor down in D12. Yeah, if you remind me, Alex, we can also send out the announcement for this. Okay, with this I come to the lecture of today. So this is the outline of the course as far as we came. First, we talked about empirics and data to learn about the phenomena we would like to describe. These were called stylized facts. Then we talked about agent-based models that were simple models we have set up to capture the stylized facts that we have observed in the data. We started with the most simple models that were stochastic growth models of non-interacting firms, and then step by step in each of the lectures we added a bit more of complexity to capture with some facts that have not been well represented by the models. And you remember that we in particular talked about indirect interactions of firms, that was interactions through the market, that was this advanced model of free market capitalism. Natalia found a few mistakes in the slide, so she made an updated version just for your information, right? And so we double-checked that all the equations were okay. And during the last lecture, we were talking about the redistribution of wealth as another indirect interaction mechanism. So the government collects some proportion of your revenue in form of a tax, and then it's redistributing this evenly. And this is another kind of indirect interaction, and those of you who followed the handout and the recording of last year you found then that we are able to reproduce some skewed distributions. We are not able to do this ourselves, but we tried to simply believe in what our Japanese colleagues did. Right? So. Today, we come to a very different topic, namely direct interactions. So far, these firms never directly interacted, but indirectly interacted. And we would like to include in this formal setup now direct interaction. And the example that we take is knowledge transfer. Some of you who take the course on economic networks will see a slight overlap with the economic network lectures. Who's taking the course? Economic network 1, 2. Okay. This is only a slight overlap. In the economic lecture, in the economic network course, we go much more into the details. Here we talk about simple models only, and I would like that you understand the kind of argumentation and the phenomena that we observe rather than doing some sort of mathematics. That's what we do in the course economic networks. So let's come back to our modeling framework. It's the same as we did before. So you have a firm characterized by X. X is a proxy for the size, and later will be a proxy for the knowledge stock of the firm. And we ask ourselves what governs the change of the size or the knowledge stock of the firm, and that has to be included in this nonlinear function f. So remember the different levels of assumptions that we made for this f function. First, there were no interaction, then there was the interaction via the mean. If you think of examples, and please also think of the model of Ejiri and Simon, there was also an indirect coupling towards the mean because the growth rates depended on the average growth of the industry or on the average growth of the economy as a whole, right? So they made these different factors there. Today, we specify this function in a different way. We have now a dependence of the f function directly on xi and xj. What does this mean? It means that the firm does not grow by itself. This was one of the assumptions of the Gebrard model, right? We didn't talk about the reason why the firm grows. We simply assumed it grows. And here, we specify the condition. It grows because it interacts with another firm J, and this firm J may have a patent or access to some special resources that firm I can use in order to grow. That's the basic idea here. So let us come to the modeling framework. We called it here cooperation. By the way, Alex, there are two mistakes on the front page, right? So if you can remind me on this, then we fix it afterwards. One issue just for your information, we are no longer using these email addresses that are printed on the first slide all the time. We have disabled these addresses. You can communicate with us via Moodle as you did all the time, right? So, okay. We call this a modeling framework for cooperation because it basically means that the firms have to cooperate. In some sense. So the proxy X is for the knowledge stock, as I mentioned before. If you want to have an idea, then it's a number of patents. Yeah? So you are a specific company that doesn't have a hot-selling product, but you have about 15,000 patents, yeah, that can be used by another company to strengthen the strategic position in the market. Yeah? Not to use 15,000 patents, not at all, but to scare the competitors. Right? So, okay. So you know a few recent examples of these kind of interactions. The knowledge growth of which is now for the x variable, is assumed to depend on two terms, which are not really specified here. There are benefits, B, and there are costs. So, of course, there has to be a benefit term. Why should you interact with other firms if there is no benefit, right? But on the other hand, you should not assume that there is no cost involved. You know, if you think of the famous Daimler-Chrysler case or something, right, then the cost for collaborating between firms, for collaboration between firms with very different internal culture and setup, was extremely high and underestimated, right? That's the problem here. So the benefit and the cost depend on the adjacency matrix. What is this? This describes the interaction. At some point, I have to describe with whom firm I interacts. And we do this in this little setup. I took this graph here from one of our early papers. And the corresponding adjacency matrix. So let's look here. You see firm one exchanged knowledge with firm two, but with no one else. So then you see here in the row, no, in the column, sorry, you see here that firm one interacts with firm two, right? There's a one and there are zeros otherwise. Firm two interacts with firm three and with firm four. So you see three and four, they are the sheer one. That means the adjacency matrix contains all the information with whom firm I interacts. That is the important message. That means we later on can treat this as a set of dynamic equations, and the adjacency matrix simply describes the interaction. So benefits in terms of knowledge transfer are called knowledge spillovers in economic models. So that means there is something more that you get by interacting with these firms. You get access to new design features. You get access to new product features, for example. You get access to a different kind of workforce. For example, if this firm is specialized on particular issues and has very skilled workers on a particular setup, for example, to develop some drugs for the pharmaceutical industry, then by interacting with these firms, you also get access to the skills of the workforce there, right? So. And the cost of collaborations, we will list a few later on. So. But it's important to have this in mind. So. From the dynamic equation, you immediately see that firm I would only interact with any other firm if the benefits are larger than the costs, right? Otherwise, it would face a decrease in the important variable, which is the knowledge stock here. So that means it invests more in the collaboration than it gains. It's a very clear thing. And this is called strategic interaction. So that means you, as an agent, calculate what are my benefits, what are my costs, and then you make a strategic decision, I interact with this guy, but not with that guy. That's the idea behind this. Okay, we look into this a bit more in detail. So we have in mind applications towards innovation networks. So, of course, firm can invent themselves and can create innovation themselves without collaborating with other firms. That happened in the past and still happens. But on the other hand, you know from other courses, in particular the MTech students, that this is not the end of the story. To have an innovation is one thing. To establish this innovation somewhere on the market, complete different thing. That means if you have the patent for whatever interface in communication, let's assume you are the inventor of Blu-ray standard or something of the HD. No? So then, of course, you have to make sure that most other firms share the standard, right? Otherwise, you will not really gain a lot of market share if the other firms follow other standards. So what you do in such a situation, you very early on make strategic interaction with these firms in order to make sure that they are involved in the development of this standard and the related patents and use them afterwards. That's the idea behind it, right? So. And you, and in most firms, so not a single firm has all the knowledge, as I mentioned before, that is needed to develop a particular patent. And it's not also a good idea to have everything in-house. It's in most cases much better to collaborate with other firms, and when once a product is developed, or once you change the focus of your production, then you have the chance to simply cut this interaction with the other firm. You do not need to lay off 1,000 people that you have hired 2 years ago to develop a particular thing, right? So you see there is an idea behind this. So that's a innovation network as it was plotted here in the NEMO project. Well, I give a hint here. So the different colors identify different types of actors in this innovation network. So there are firms, there are universities, and there are other government agencies, for example. So now let's come to the model in particular. I said that now the interaction function depends on xj, xk, and so on. We could also assume it depends on xi. If it depends on xi, then we are back in the square where we talk about the multiplicative growth, for example, right? So I want to separate these two effects. Therefore, I today only talk about the dependence on the other firms. I could, as I said, also assume it depends on my own knowledge stock. Yeah, but for the modeling purpose, to show how much is the growth due to interaction and not to myself, yeah. Because I want to separate these effects, I assume that F only depends on other firms. So. And then we can have this equation here as the most simple assumption. So I wanted to use this feature today. So do you like this or not? I have seen that even in the video you can see the red laser pointer, right? But only if you know that I used it. It's very interesting, and this can be surely seen, I assume, right? So the first and most simple assumption is it depends on other firms XJ. These are the entries of the adjacency matrix that describe with whom I interact. And then instead of having costs directly involved in the interaction, I assume there are some general costs. So they are expressed in this term with the phi. So that means there is a constant cost proportional to my own growth. If I interact with you, so then I have to increase my administration in the company, I have to have an office that's related to capture all the contracts that describe the interaction with you and to check this and to archive this and so on and so on. So you can assume that we can capture the cost by this gross term here. It's not a cost specifically related to my interaction with you. It's a general cost related to the fact that I interact with other people and therefore grow. Right? And the more I grow, that means the more I interact with other people or with other firms, the higher is this cost. So you understand what the meaning of this is. Yeah? So in a physical, yeah, please.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
To either one or zero, where one is some other can you just elaborate a bit more on the how?
No, it simply means that the growth of my knowledge stock depends on your knowledge stock. It's proportional to your knowledge stock. If you are the firm with the 1,000 patents and I interact with you, then I grow more when if you are the firm with the one patent, right? That's the idea here. So, but the important assumption here is it does not depend on my knowledge stock. And I explained why I have chosen this assumption to simplify the problem and to really look into what's the meaning of the interaction here. Yeah? So. For the adjacency matrix, we can, in the simplest case, assume a random network. A random network is, if you have the nodes, which represent the firms, then you draw random lines with a certain probability. Yeah? You choose two firms, and then with a probability P, which is maybe 0.2, you draw a line between these firms, right? And then you get a random network. And if you know the P, that's maybe the M or the P is an important variable here. If you know the P, that means the probability that you and I have a link. So then I can calculate the number of firms on average, yeah? Because there are N minus other firms in the system. And with each of them, I probe a link, which is accepted with a probability P, then the M is the average number of links. Okay. We can assume that this cost or dilution flux can be set to zero. I mean, the phi is an arbitrary constant, so we can, for simplicity, set this to zero if we want. So, and then we see that this is nothing but exponential growth, where here the A is the adjacency matrix and the X0 is the knowledge stock of all these firms that have been connected to me initially. Right? So that means this is a vector here, and then we can calculate how the knowledge stock of all the firms develop over time. But what we do is we transfer this equation into a market share equation by simply using relative variables. Then instead of having this simple expression, we get a more complicated expression here. But this is due to the fact that I go for relative variables and that the market share is constrained to one, the sum is constrained to one, right? You can do this little exercise at home to transfer equation one to this equation, if you want, no? But it's a very simple way of getting this. Okay, now we do some computer simulations to better understand how the firms evolve. So. And we make the following important assumptions. There are two time scales in the system. There is one time scale at which the firm increases its knowledge stock, dx after dt. And there is a second time scale at which the firm decides with whom to interact. So we have a random link together, so we interact, I calculate my knowledge stock, then I find out this is not sufficient. My costs are higher than my benefits, for example. Here there are no costs, direct costs, as I said, but that's irrational. Yeah? And then I basically cut the link and try with someone else. Right? That's the idea. So that means there are two time scales. One time scale at which the dx after dt relaxes to a stationary state, and then another time scale at which this stationary state is perturbed by changing the interaction pattern. Now, this is a basic idea. Did you understand what I just said? That's important. So, we have this coupled set of equations, xi, dxi after dt. Then we calculate, given the fixed network structure, what is the growth of the knowledge stock. Then we end up in stationary values, right? This relaxes, as I have shown on the last slide. So, and then something is changed. That's the interaction pattern. Instead of interacting with you in the next round, I interact with you. So that means some of the links are rewired. That's the idea here. We have a specific assumption about the rewiring mechanism. We rank the firms. So you know already from the last lecture about inequality and the Lorentz covariance ranking of firms means. So we start with the best performing firm, which has the highest XI, and then order them towards the least performing firms. So there's always the best firm, and there is the second best, and so on. And then we decide that the least performing firm is removed from the system. That's our idea. So we remove this firm because it's not well performing, and we replace this firm by a new firm. That means in this model, there's entry and exit dynamics. So the exit is only for one firm, that's the least performing firm. And in order to keep the number of firms constant, we have a new firm added to the system. And how does this new firm interact with the existing firms? By a random wiring to existing firms with the probability P. The new firm gets links assigned to the existing firms. That's the idea of this model. Are there any questions about the model? It's a very simple model. And now we can ask the following question. What's the likelihood that I am hit by the remover, yeah? That I am the least performing firm in this simulation model? That's an important question. Or you can put it the other way around. What's the likelihood that I'm always one of the good firms, the well-performing firms? And the second question is, does the whole pattern converges to some favorite network topology? Remember, the network topology represents the interaction patterns. You can ask, is there an optimal interaction of the firms? That's a question. No? Okay. So we do it very simple here. We look into some computer simulations. So we start at t equals 0. We have, I think, 100 firms. These firms are randomly connected to other firms. We calculate their XI. We look which one is the least performing firm. That's removed. A new firm is put into the system that gets the number of this previous firm and is randomly rewired to the existing set of firms. And then we recalculate what is the knowledge stock in the next firm. If there is nothing about you, you have not been included in the rewiring mechanism, then of course your knowledge stock doesn't change in the next step, right? So only for those where some changes occurred, the knowledge stock would change. And this is an arbitrary snapshot. So what do we see? First of all, we see a number of firms that are completely isolated here, right? They do not interact with anyone. So that means their knowledge stock is probably very low, right? Why are they still in the system? How many? Right, right. These are the least performing firms, but thanks God, they are not the only ones, right? So that means every time where someone is chosen for removal, there is plenty of choice, right? So, okay. That's the first thing. Then you see these clusters here that emerge. And then you also see that there are long chains. So 84 depends on the growth, or 84 not depends, but supports the growth of knowledge stock of 50, and so on. So there are these chains. So let's go to another arbitrary time step. So I have marked a number of firms in red. So why did I do this? In order to show you that there is a cycle. Actually, there are two cycles in this picture. 21, 37 or so. I cannot read this here. So, okay, I do not need to read some numbers, but you see them, right? So they form a cycle. That is a very important issue. If you are the firm 21, why should you support firm number 37, in growing its knowledge stock, right? Because there is a random link, but okay, why should you do this, right? As if you think of a rational decision. We can also go back to this little picture that we had before here. So you see there are only indirect interactions. So firm one supports the growth of firm two, but firm two does not support the growth of firm one, right? So why should firm one support the growth of firm two? What's the reason for this? Is there any incentive to do this? That's the question here, right? So, and this is answered in this picture here. These red firms form a cycle. You see, step by step, so. This supports this firm, that supports that firm, and so on. So, and 49 supports 21. So, that means even if 21 has nothing to get from 37, it still contributes to the knowledge growth of 37 because we are all part of a cycle, right? And therefore, it gets from another firm, which it's not directly supporting. That's the most important thing. Do you understand this? So. And then there is a second cycle, which you hopefully see. It's between 49 and, what's this, 8. Yeah? So they mutually benefit each other. So. And now you see that these firms always get or gain in knowledge growth because they are part of a cycle. That means they support others, but at the same time, they get through the cycle support from others, right? And if we now look for the least performing firms, the red ones are certainly not the least performing firms, right? There's always someone in the system that is much worse in performance than the red firms here. Do you understand this? Very important. So we call this indirect cooperation because there is no direct interaction between all these firms or indirect reciprocity. Direct reciprocity is a trivial thing, yeah? I benefit you because you benefit me, right? So that's direct reciprocity. Indirect reciprocity is much, much more difficult to explain. I support you despite the fact that I never get anything back from you. Why do I do this? That's an important question in economics. It's a question in game theory, but also in social sciences. Why should I support you? And here you see the answer. I support you because I get indirectly from us being part of a society, group, cycle here in this network terms and so on. That's the reason. Okay. And now these guys are quite safe. Whenever the least performing agent is chosen, they are fine. So they are not selected. So you see, this is another snapshot. What do you recognize? That this cycle is growing, right? The number of red firms connected among each other is growing. Why are they growing? Because there is this random rewiring after every time step. That means a new firm, by chance, has a link to the cycle, or another cycle appears just by chance, right? And if this cycle ever appears, all the firms that are part of the cycle benefit a lot from this indirect reciprocity. You understand what I mean? So, and therefore, they will no longer be removed from the system because they are the well-performing agents, right? So, and as long as there are white firms in the system, there's plenty of choice to remove these, right? Because they are always less performing than the red ones. And therefore, of course, the cycles are growing all the time. Because the white firms are removed, new firms come into the system, are randomly rewired to the system, connections to other firms, and then may either form a new cycle or become part of a cycle. That's the idea here. Okay. So we see a core of cooperating firms, and then we also see this here. We see this parasitic periphery. So why are these guys there? Let's look here at 97, 52, and 94. Why are they there, right? Because they benefit from the fact that 13 is doing so well, right? That's the idea. They never contribute anything to 13, but thanks to the fact that 13 benefits 97, and 97 has a lot of growth from this benefit, 42 and 94 also benefit, but to a less and less and less degree. So that means there is a point in time where the whole thing, where these firms will be removed. And now let's assume, without looking into further snapshots, what will happen in the next time step. Or not the next time step, in some time step in the future. Who of you can imagine how the whole game will end?
The numbers of nodes in the core will grow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are only firms in one or two cores. It does not necessarily have to be one core. But at the end, we have a situation where we have all the red firms only, right? And that's the most important day, right? Because then we look for the least performing firm. And the least performing firm now, for the first time, is a red firm, not a white, because the whites are all gone. We pick one of the red firms and we remove it from the system. And what do we do by this? We destroy the cycle, right? Because the red firm had a connection, yeah, an incoming connection, benefited from another firm, and gave something to another firm. And that firm is removed, so that means the whole cycle collapses, right? You understand why, right? That means, let's put it like this. The worst case scenario is not that we feed a parasitic periphery, right? So we can afford this, right? So if we are the red firms, no? We can afford feeding the parasitic periphery. The worst case scenario is if there is no parasitic periphery anymore, because then it's on us, yeah, to be removed. That's the problem. Right? And that's the same as you, if you think of this competition model, of indirect competition model of free capitalism. No? As long as there was a least performing firm in the system, right? This was fine. Your fitness was above the average because there were guys in the system that were not performing well, right? The problem just occurs if these guys are no longer there, because then you are the least performing firm, right? So therefore, you understand that the ensemble plays a huge role here. It's not bad to have other least performing firms in the system, because this improves your ranking. Yeah? So what we see here in this graph is indeed what we have just described. We see that The network, so M, remember, is the average number of links. Yeah? It's scaled by the total number of firms. So that's network time here. And then you see that a network is growing. Let's look for the first, for the blue curve here. So the network is growing here. And then at some certain point, you see crashes. These crashes occur because the cycle was hit by the selection process. There were no parasitic firm anymore, no white firm. There were only red firms, and they were taken out, and therefore the whole thing collapses. The shocks are more severe, as you can see, if the link density is not very high. That's very understandable. If you have a sparse network, if you have only a few interactions, then, of course, you have not many cores. You have maybe one core or two cores. And if these are destroyed, then you see a real drop down, right? So whereas here, the shocks are not very severe because there are, because of the high link densities, the high number of interactions, you have always some firms to interact with, right? So I hope you understand the meaning of this. This is our baseline model. The baseline model was taken from prebiotic evolution. So we were actually not talking about firms, but about catalytic cycles in prebiotic evolution. That's where the model was developed for. But it describes something that we can well understand. For the rest of the lecture, we do nothing to then making this physics or biologic model an economic model. That means we go now and add step by step things that are important to understand to become an economic model. So we extend now the basic model, as I said. So the first and most important thing is if you compare this model that I just described in detail with an economic model is this assumption of random links, right? So that's the first thing that the economist tells you, okay, there is no random linkage to other firms. A firm carefully decides with whom to interact, and that's the first thing we have to put into the model, right? It's very clear. So the second thing is if we do this, we should not assume that the firm knows all other firms in the system, right? That's very important. So the firms have maybe some finite information only. So that's called bounded rationale. Let's see that we get this into this model. And the third assumption is we should not avoid the costs, right? If firms decide to interact with someone, then there are costs involved. It's not like on Facebook where you have 2,000 friends, yeah? Why do you have 2,000 friends? Because it doesn't cost you anything to have 2,000 friends, right? So if you really had to communicate with them, yeah, in a pairwise interaction, you would very soon realize that the cost outperformed the benefits, right? But because this is not implemented, therefore, it's not bad. But in a real economy, it's important that you consider the cost of interaction with a particular firm. Okay. So now let us go for this. There's a bit of math, but you should not be scared. So let us drop first for a moment the assumption of the cost. Then the equation looks like this. We already discussed this. And from this bare equation, where we have no cost involved, we can calculates a gross return. That's simply dividing x dot, which is the growth rate, by the size of the firm. And we can prove that for this gross return, we can estimate this by the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix. That's something we capture in detail in the economic network lecture, but not here. You simply assume this. How can I know about gross return? I can proxy it by the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix. That's also called Frobenius-Perron eigenvalue, right? Therefore, the PF there. So we continue right after the break of 10 minutes now. So what is cool about this equation? If we can estimate the gross return by the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix, it's cool that we do not need to solve dynamic equations, right? So we have a good proxy, and that's sufficient. So we are in economics here, and no longer in, I don't know, nonlinear dynamics. So that means people are not really interested in solving this equation. They're interested in proving something about them. That's a different thing. So, okay, then this is the approximation for the costs. If we go, this is the approximation for the benefits, yeah, the gross return. Now let us introduce the costs to the model here. So we can introduce the net return, which is a small r, and that's a benefit minus a cost. What are the costs? The costs are what I have to invest in order to keep the links active. So each link has the same cost, that's the assumption here, and ki is the number of links that I have to maintain. And if I, because I do not want to solve this equation here in time, I use the approximation for the asymptotic limit, namely that the Ri is estimated by the largest eigenvalue here, and these are the costs. This holds on the long run for asymptotic times, right? But that's enough for what we want to do with this. We are not, as I said, interested in these intermediate steps. So we now define a performance measure, which is called pi here. And pi is the social welfare. We come to the definition of the social welfare here. So the social welfare is basically the sum over all benefits minus all of the costs. That's the idea. So, and we call a network efficient if the social welfare, that means this difference between cost and benefit, is maximized. This is a specific notion of the term efficient. Efficient is not what you and I think efficient would mean. Efficient is a firmly defined term in economics. The network is called efficient if it maximizes the social welfare. Right? It's something you would maybe dub with another term. Therefore, it's important that you understand that that's the meaning of efficiency. And now we would like to find out what we can learn about the social welfare. So now there is a difference between, let's say, econophysics and economics. In econophysics, you probably would have started by simulating these equations for a number of firms and looking into how the average link density evolves and all these sort of things, right? Exactly as you have seen in the different snapshots. But this is not what we do in economics and not what we're interested in. What we do now is we prove a number of things about this equation. And we are in particular interested in the fact what's the role of the cost here. That is the difference to the baseline model, if you recall, right? So is there a cost that is critical for forming a network, for example? Do we see that no network evolves if we reach a critical cost, for example? These are questions. And here, as I said, I'm not interested in doing the proofs with you. If you want, you can go to the papers and can look them up. You also find them in the literature folder here. What I present here are just the results. And remember that we are interested in the cost. And we didn't do any simulation, we just proved this. And this is also the argument why we have chosen linear cost. Because with linear cost, you can prove everything. We first started with nonlinear cost, and we could not prove everything. And then the paper was also not accepted in the economics journals. What was? Pardon me? At the moment, it's linear.
Yeah, gravity.
Yeah, of course, yeah. So we started with nonlinear functions, and we come later to quadratic cost as well. But that was not accepted because you could not prove about it. So you see, method first, right? So we better use the not so realistic assumption, but prove everything, than using the realistic assumption and not proving everything, right? So that's a trade-off. Yeah, I mentioned this in particular for the three physicists here, right? So that's a difference, basically. Yeah? Okay, this is what we have proven. The most important thing is that you understand that there are critical values of the C. You can see this in the same way as we talk about phase transitions or bifurcations in nonlinear dynamics, right? So, if the C is, this is a normalized cost, if the C is larger than 1 in a normalized way, then the efficient network is the empty graph. Remember what the efficient network is? That is a network that maximizes the social welfare, and we also know precisely how the network looks like. There is no network, right? That's the first answer. Then the second important proof is the C is less than 1, the network is connected. Okay, this means there is one component. It's not the case that we have three different components, for example, that are separate. There's one component. And then the third important threshold involved here, if the C is less than 0.5, the efficient network is a fully connected graph. Everyone understands what a fully connected graph is. Everyone has a link to everyone else, right? So. And then there are a few specific proofs for what happens between 1/2 and 1. Below 1/2, we know fully connected network. What is between 1/2 and 1? So there are specific mixtures of hubs and cliques. So these are structures in the network, and we are able to provide a formal algorithm that constructs the efficient network. That's the meaning. I think we captured this in the lecture economic network, so I skip it here. What this tells you is we know an algorithm that constructs the efficient network for us if the C is in between, which is also very nice. So that means we do not really need to do computer simulations. We can write down in a formal way how the network will be constructed and looks like. So, okay. So the first general insight is very obvious. The higher the cost, the sparser the network, right? Below 1/2, fully connected. Above 1, nothing. So that's very clear. The second nice thing, also from the viewpoint of the economist, is there is always an efficient network, even if it doesn't look like what we assumed, in particular the empty network, right? So in particular, this is important here, between 1/2 and 1, we know how the efficient network looks like. Yeah? So. Okay, these are the proofs, and now let us go to the computer simulation and let's see if we find these structures that we have just proven to exist. This is a different thing. I want you to really understand the difference here. What we did is we have proven the existence of a state. But we have not proven that we reach this state. These are two different things, right? So think about the paradise, right? So we know that the paradise exists. But we cannot find any way from where we are now to the paradise. This is a complete different thing, right? So, and we are addressing this question now. How does it look like if we try to get to the efficient network where we already have proven how the network looks like? Right. So, and we do this here with this simulation. We start with an empty graph. So, and then we have the same assumption of the separation of the time scales as before. We take two agents, and then we change something about the link structure. We let the whole system relax into a quasi-stationary state. Then we change the network, let it relax again and again and again. So that's the idea. So, and for the perturbation of the network, we have now a few more refined assumptions. Remember what the economists have criticized about the baseline model. Yeah? The baseline model, we did everything with random choice. Yeah? There was a random link, and then someone was taken from the system, and a firm was replacing this least performing agent and was randomly rewired to the rest of the system, and so on. So this was a criticism. Therefore, we start now with the empty network. So that means the number of links is growing all the time. We do not change the number of nodes, as you see, right? So we have 100 nodes, let's assume. And then we choose two agents, and we think about whether these agents link or not. And we have two different mechanisms, so which looks like a Roman 2 here means II, incremental improvement. You know? II means it. And best response. What do we mean by incremental improvement? So we take two agents A and J. Every of these agents calculates the net return. Remember what the net return was? I think it was written on the previous slide. Benefit minus cost, right? For himself. And then, if we find out that you and I are both better off by keeping the link, then we accept to have the link. If we find out that I am better off, but you are not, we are not accepting the link. I would probably accept the link, but you not, right? Because why should you do it? That's the idea of incremental improvement, right? You understand this? So, then the second, just to contrast this procedure, is called best response. I and J are taken, and look into the possibility to have a link. But before I and J make any decision, they calculate what will happen if instead of J, I take a link to K, or to M, or to N, or to any other agent in the system. So that means the agent, before committing himself to this link, makes a huge calculation by checking every other possibility in the system. That's called best response. And only after this very strong procedure, it turns out that this is the best choice I could have, then I take the link. If it turns out that this is not the best choice, I would not accept the link, right? I cannot link it to someone else, but I would not accept this link. You understand the difference, right? One is I just check the link between you and me, and the other one is I check every single link in the system. So the criticism is really obvious. You have to know in best response who are the other agents in the system. You have to do a very computationally costly procedure to find out what would be the case if I were to link to you, and so on, right? So, okay. So, and then we stop if we do not find any better improvement in the system, so, which means for incremental improvement, bilaterally stable network. So that means for any two links, we do not find a better solution. And for best response, it's a Nash equilibrium. I'm just mentioning this to tell you that there's a difference in this. So now let's look into the average return, that's a performance criterion, over the time, time measured in networks update. And then you see, so this is the cost here, that in best response you reach about 45 here. So what's the meaning of 45? 45 means, so we have 50 agents, no? 50 agents, and we have normalized the whole thing in such a way that so the maximum return would be 50 for the 50 agents. So if we are linked to all other agents, of course we have some costs, right? 50 times 0.01 is 5, right? No? So that means it's somewhere around 45. That's the best response. That sounds good. So that means we find what's supposed to be, from a rough calculation, the optimal revenue, right? So, and what is with the best response with the incremental improvement? It's less than this. Aha. So why is it less? Because these other agents, they have checked all possibilities, right? Well, these agents just took the first offer and took it after they found out that that's not worse than what they have right now, right? So, but now comes the interesting thing here. So, this is what you would expect, right? So you think more information is always better, yeah? I go to the media market and I inform myself about a camera, so, but then before I buy this in the media market, I go to all these other shops and compare the price, and then I go to the online shops and compare the price, and then I find the best offer, right? So you think more information is better. So, and this seems to confirm this picture, but only if the costs are very low. The costs increase, you see that the picture inverts. The best response agent do not get higher revenue. That's what I wrote here. Yeah? Above a critical C, incremental improvement is better. So. And that's something we would like to understand now. So we do this by looking into these graphs. So remember what we have proven before. I just gave you the results. If the C was less than 0.5, what do we get? So the fully connected network, right? So that was the proof. And it pretty much looks like a fully connected network if the cost is very low. Remember, best response even finds this network, right? But what happens if we increase the cost? So let's take point two. What did we prove? There should be a fully connected network, right? And what do these stupid agents do? So they do not find the fully connected network, right? Instead, what they find as an equilibrium network, this one. So that means they do not find the efficient network for interaction. They find another network, and that's even an equilibrium network, but it is not efficient. Efficient means it maximizes the social welfare. And this does not maximize the social welfare. This is simply the best they could get under the current condition, right? The maximum is somewhere else, probably here, right? So that is what you have to have in mind to interpret this result. So why don't these agents find it? That's the question now. We have proven how it should look like. And these agents, by making strategic decisions, do not find it. What is the reason? So, the reason is in the past dependence of the way they create their interaction networks. Remember, I'm not sure how much you are familiar with evolutionary optimization or these kind of things, probably a bit, right? So. Okay. For for the given cost, the structure of the landscape looks a bit like this, yeah? Okay? That's the structure of the landscape. So we have proven that this is the best, yeah? So fully connected network. That's what we know, okay? Well, we start somewhere here, right? So, and now you are agent I and you are agent K. So, you accept this because you think, okay, now I have nothing, then I have something, so let's accept this link, right? And then, by accepting this decision, you end up in this state. So that is an equilibrium state, but it is not the best equilibrium that exists, right? So, but from this state, you can never leave, right? That's a problem. And it's even worse for the best response case. Because in the best response case, after you got into one of these, you calculate all the other possibilities, and then you find out, well, these are all worse than what I have now. This is understandable, because you see, it takes a long, long way to get out of this hole and then into this here, right? So that means you have to accept, in order to find the paradise, you have to accept a huge detour of states that are worse than what you have now, right? You understand what I mean? So that is a very important insight. And because you are the best response agent and you have checked all possibilities, you will never ever accept any deterioration, yeah? Anything that is worse than what you have now. So that means the best response agent is even more trapped than the incremental improvement agent. The incremental improvement agent, by chance, may find a way out, because by putting you into my network and by accepting a link, I of course change the global structure. For me it's beneficial, but I could probably make a jump from here to there, right? So that's possible for incremental improvement, but it's not possible for best response. So, and then you end up here where you are maybe very close to the optimum. No? That's the idea. So I want you to understand this. No? So that means a historic evolution. What we have observed here, like we start with an empty network and we let the network grow until it finds a equilibrium state. So if we consider this evolution, we create a path dependence, and that means that we get stuck in equilibrium state that are not optimal, or they are called here, is it written here, inefficient equilibrium, or suboptimal states. And evolutionary optimization techniques, of course, deal a lot with how you can get off these kind of states, right? So, but here, because we are thinking of rational agents or bounded rational agents that carefully decide about having a link or not, yeah, you never leave.
So to be rational sometimes is important.
To be irrational, yes, of course, yes. This is very important, yeah? So, and you see here, we have still proven the fully connected network is the efficient one, right? And now you see what they did, yeah? Please.
But it's more like a philosophical remark.
Mm-hmm.
If you're really rational, mm-hmm. then you must also incorporate this knowledge in your thinking.
Yes. This is true. This would be, let's call, the second order rationality, right? So, but rational means, in the sense it's used in economics, means not that you have higher knowledge about global states. This is not the assumption. A rational agent is an assumption, is an agent that has full knowledge about his decisions and the consequences, and the decisions of the other and their consequences. So that means I could calculate, if I think about our interaction, I could assume a mindset where I think like you and then argue about your consequences. This is the assumption. That means I could take your mind and see the system, and I could take my mind and see the system. But it does not mean, rationality means not, that I'm God, Father, looking into the system and see how these stupid guys, by their full rationality, have a global state emerging. Right? That's something you cannot really predict. Yeah? Because that's a collective effect. So this is something that is not part of your strategic thinking. You understand what I mean? So even if you calculate your own utility for a longer time horizon, yeah, you may not see this because that is something that is not. It's not a property that is associated to other agents, it's a property that is associated to the whole system, right? So. But that's it's a tricky point, actually. Yeah?
So the utility theory is not complete.
There is another state? There is an emerging state that is not likely foreseen by the agents, because the agents only argue on the level of the agents. They know about your decisions and their consequences, or they can assume this. So, but they only argue about your utility function, not the utility function of the system. You understand? That's a difference. This is not additive. Yeah? Think about public good games or these kind of things, right? So public good games, so we all make the wrong decision, yeah? Right? Being free riders and not cooperators. Right, that's the situation of the public good game. Whereas if we would, so that's a rational decision. We have our two choices, and then we see, okay, this choice costs me more than another one. So therefore, I take the other one, right, which is free riding. That means I'm rational in my decision. But I'm not counting in that the whole system, including myself, in the next and upper next time step becomes is in a worse state than it is now. That's a different thing. Yeah? Rationality always refers to the decisions that are made on the agent level, based on the utility function on the agent level. Yeah? That's important to know, but it's a good point. Okay, now let's move on a bit to incorporate other things. So we have talked about costs now. But we have not talked about breaking up links. That's something we didn't discuss yet. Or did I include this? Let me just check. No. So now let us assume that we want to break up our link because we find out that we should better invest into something else. And then we have a cost involved. So here we see incremental improvement is for the way we are creating links. Again, both of us benefit. But now, if after some time, if we evaluate our personal network, if we find out there is a link that is no longer beneficial for me, then I am allowed to cancel this link. And I do this decision myself. Here, both of us in incremental improvement have to agree to create the link. So that means both of us have to benefit from it. But here it's a different way. It's sufficient that one of us has less benefit from this link. So think of relationships, yeah? So, yeah, you can break up your marriage if you want, though you do not need the agreement of your wife, for example, right? So, but the assumption here is that, of course, you do not get your full investment back. You have invested time, you have invested knowledge, for example, in the case of knowledge transfer, that you have transferred to the agent and so on. So, only a part of this. And we measure this by a so-called severance cost. And here you just have to keep in mind alpha equal null, zero means nothing we get back. And alpha equal one means we get back our full investment. then you can assume how the network would look like. Does someone have a guess how the network would look like for these two extreme cases? Who has a clue? Huh? What about the upper rows there? Huh? What would the network look like? If you get nothing back by breaking up, then of course it's not rational to break up, right? So, true? Because you lose a huge investment that you made over the years, right? So. Instead of that was this case, yeah, full loss of memory. If you have no loss of investment, then you can all the time change your relationship to other companies with no cost, and you will reach a more efficient state much more easier, because all the time you evaluate your links, right? So. Okay, here we look into this. This is the case where you do not get back anything, right? And then you see that you have this very sparse structure of the network. And so there are not very many links, but the agents also do not really collaborate. I mean, if you see this here, then you can imagine that from these cycle structures, in particular, look at this cluster, you get a lot of benefit because these agents fully they collaborate in a very nice way, right? So, but there are other structures like these peripheric parasites, for example, that are not cut off. Why are they not cut off? Well, because it costs, you lose your investment, though. Then at some point, it's much cheaper to just let them run and stay in the network. So, and now we increase the alpha to 1, right? So, and then you see that the network becomes much denser. Why does it become much denser? Because the agents have more possibilities to rewire the link and to find better possibilities, right? These other agents get stuck very early in the previous picture. In this picture, they become much, much more fluent in rewiring the links. And here you see the most optimal structure that they can get. Remember what we have discussed before? An efficient network in these kind of models should include a fully connected network. Remember this? So if you look here, then you see these are all fully connected networks. That means they are close to be efficient network. The real efficient network for this case would be which one? Globally. Yeah, where we have one globally connected, where everyone is globally connected to each other. So this is no longer possible because of this incremental improvement, right? So these agents, because they are already connected to all their neighbors, have no reason to break one link up and to rewire it to someone else, right? So, because it's always beneficial for them to keep these links. Yeah. So therefore, we see these clusters of fully connected networks here, if there are no severance costs. So, if there are, again, if there are no costs, it means the agents can try more, because there is no consequence in first probing this partner, then probing that partner, then probing that partner, and so on and so on. There's no cost involved. Therefore, the agent can try better and find the more optimal structure. We still understand that this is not the most optimal structure, the global optimal structure, but it's very close to it, right? At least locally, we see these patterns. You understand? If I instead increase the severance cost, so, and remember that in this model, alpha equals 0 was the loss of the full investment, then you have this picture, right? A very sparse network, which is completely suboptimal, but the agents do not change it, because they fear the loss of what they have invested. Okay. Now, let us move in the last 5 minutes towards non-linear costs. As we already discussed, the non-linear case is the more realistic one, but on the other hand, the one where you can not prove everything in a nice way, as this was possible for the previous two cases. What we did now is we included the dynamics looks a bit differently. We have a dissipation term here that already appeared in the baseline model, if you remember, right? So there was some dissipation. The more you grow, the more you also lose because of your organizational costs, for example. Then you have this benefit term, which is the same as we have discussed before, and you recognize that it only depends on the other agent's knowledge stock if you gain, otherwise not. And then you have this additional term of cost that goes with x squared. What's the difference between these costs and these costs? So these are costs that appear for interaction. Right? So it's proportional to Aij. If you do not interact, then you do not have this cost. This cost you always have. This is, let's assume that's a tax you have to pay or something like this. Yeah? It's proportional to your knowledge stock. Yeah? And this only appears for the interaction. And we do now the following. We have two different strategies for the link creation and for the link deletion. There is the unilateral link deletion and creation. That means only I decide about this. So I evaluate you as a potential partner, and then I create a link. If it's beneficial, and if I find out that it's not beneficial, I cut the link, right? So. Or the other one is I evaluate this possibility, but you also evaluate this possibility. And only if the two of us gain, as in the case of incremental improvement, we create a link. And only if the two of us lose, we break up. That's the idea here. Yeah? Okay. And so the assumption then is that, of course, we do not have all the information about all the other agents in the system. This is also important. So let us now look into some computer simulation. This computer simulation you have already seen here. That's the baseline case. This is the result of the baseline model that we have assumed. In the baseline model, remember, we had a core of cooperating agents. There can be more than one core if possible, yeah? And then we have this periphery of agents that simply are parasitic, yeah? That benefit from the existence of the core. And we use this, what was the outcome of the baseline model, as the starting point for our quadratic cost model now. So, and this is what you get here. So here was the assumption that we have what's called here random unilateral link creation. That means I randomly create a link to you, but I then check all my links, and if the link is not optimal, I cut it again. You understand? So that means I have potentially everyone in the system as a cooperation partner, but I also check whether this cooperation is useful or beneficial for me. And if not, I cut the link. That's the idea. So we start here, and that's what we get at the end. So, yeah?
So when do you possibly delete the link? Is it after running the whole system?
Yes, this is again with the two time scales. So I calculate my x, right? Everyone calculates his knowledge stock, and then after this, we change the network. And then we pick you as an agent, and you evaluate your link structure, right?
Because it's also possible to do it
No, you do it the other way around. So you create a link, the system runs. You check. And then you are picked for checking your links, right? And then you find out, okay, some of the links didn't give me that much what I was expecting. Right? And then you delete one of your links. That's the idea. So that means the link creation and the link deletion is basically in between there is the knowledge growth, because you need to get the chance to find out whether this was beneficial or not, right? You can assume that these agents are all capable of doing this in their mind, but the assumption is a different one, right? So there's a stage where we randomly rewire links to other agents, then we let the knowledge stock grow, and then we check, okay, who actually contributed to my knowledge stock and who not. And then we make a link deletion. So, and this is the result of it. The result is not surprising, right? Because we see that only those links survive where we have a bilateral connection. So, if you do not benefit to my growth and I will cut the link. But the other way around, it's also true. If I do not benefit for your growth, to your growth, you will also cut the link. So at the end, only those links survive, which by chance are bilateral links. Right? So in this random creation, there were a few events that created bilateral links, and they will survive, right? So in the other case, you think about the cycle, right? So the cycle was also beneficial for us. But I cannot know that the cycle is beneficial for us. I just look at you, and then I see you do not contribute to my growth, right? So therefore, I cut the link. I'm stupid idiot, yeah? So because by this cutting the link, I also kill the cycle, right? But that's something I cannot know because I don't have a global picture. That is what I said on the previous slide, right? And therefore, these cycles do not exist anymore, but only bilateral links. And free riders, of course, are completely isolated here, right? Because everyone checks that he doesn't get anything from these. Okay. Now let us move to the second example, to speed up a bit. So now we assume that we have random bilateral link creation and optimal bilateral link deletion. Bilateral, different from unilateral, means I and you have to agree on this, not just me. So. And then you see we start with the previous picture from the previous slide, the end state, where we had this bilateral interactions all the time. And then we see that what is the result of this assumption? Only a fully connected cluster appears. Yeah? So that means so those guys who were free riders in the first instance, they don't count anymore, right? So, and those guys who have some connections to neighbors merge together in a cluster where they all connect. Because this is, from here to there, you understand that this is more beneficial, right? So. Whereas in this other interactions, there is no chance of being more beneficial. So that's a rational decision that they then form one cluster. Yeah? Okay, and now the last case is the one where we weight the links. So we say, okay, if there is this additional term now with benefits that are associated to shorter paths. So I can have access to your patent through 10 other firms. But maybe I have access to you directly or only through one other firm. Then we give these shorter access to knowledge a higher weight. That's the assumption here, right? So that's the first assumption. And the second assumption is that if we recognize, let me just finish with this, if we recognize that these new links contribute to a cycle, if we can foresee this, then we give it a higher weight because we can have this indirect benefit as we learned already. And then you see from this starting point, we end up, of course, in something that has cycles, right? It's not very much surprising because we were able to foresee this possibility and therefore gave more attention and more weight to these decisions, right? That was the idea. Okay. So with these simulations, I want to close. So we have seen a different viewpoint here. Today we took the picture of firms directing interaction with each other. So that was the viewpoint of today instead of indirect interaction. We started with a very simple model where this interaction was randomly assigned. That was our baseline model. But then we increased the complexity of the model by assuming why is a firm interacting with another firm. And there were these different benefits and the different costs involved. That is what we did today. So this is called strategic decision. Yeah, or strategic network formation, because a firm has a certain strategy to follow this or that alternative. So we talked about optimal structure and why the firms do not find this optimal structure, even that we have proven that this optimal structure should exist. Right? Okay. So then there are a few challenges involved. I mean, we're talking about only small networks today. Are we able, by using these models, to explain, for example, large R&D networks? That's one question, I mean. You understood that the firms do local decisions, but if I look into a macroscopic picture, am I able to use these very simple individual models where an agent makes rational decision to get a macroscopic structure? That's one challenge. So. And then, of course, we would like to see more realistic structures, and we would like to link this to observations. So the two slides that follow here are just copied from a talk of mine where I talk about financial networks and economic networks. So they are just as appetizers for your interest in economic networks. So remember that we use this, teach this course in parallel. So, okay. So, this is for you. You have to create this baseline model to understand how it works, right? It's very easy. And these are the questions. You should be able to answer the questions. I'm not interested in any proofs or something like this, but you should at least understand these kind of things. For example, why does the network break down in the baseline case? You know? Why is it that from a random network with cycles, I end up only in this bilateral interactions? Or why is it that from the bilateral interactions, I get a fully connected cluster? What has changed in the incentives? Remember that the benefits, they define an incentive structure for the firm. And dependent on the net benefits, that means benefits minus cost, I can somehow structure the network, right, as you have seen. I get different types of networks by tuning the incentives. And you should understand what has changed in the incentive structure that we get from this picture to the other picture. So thank you very much for your attention.